Lahore is one of the oldest cities in the world. It was on the main road from Delhi to Central Asia. It's a cultural center. It's an ancient city. It was a city of gardens. And so I grew up going to one of the best schools in Pakistan, which was next to my house. And I played cricket in one of the most beautiful grounds in Pakistan, which was also close to my house. And my house was on the suburbs of Lahore. Where I grew up, it was like I was growing up on a farm. Right now, it's in the middle of in the city because the city has grown so much.
أنت الابن الوحيد بين أربع فتيات. هل تمنيت أن يكون لك شقيق؟
I always wished I had a brother. Always. Because, you know, I used to be very sporty and outdoor. I was always out of the house either. It was like growing on a farm. So I had my air gun, I was shooting, or I was trying to play cricket. And so I really missed not having brothers. Sometimes I forced my sisters to play with them, but, you know, they didn't want to play cricket.
كيف تصف والدك وما الذي تعلمته منه؟
My father was a brilliant man. He was a mathematician and he was a maths genius. He wanted me to work with him. He started his own company, first Pakistan consultancy firm he set up in Pakistan, engineering firm. When I left university, he had an office for me so that I would work in his firm. And first day I said, look, you know, I said, give me 1 year to play cricket and then I'll start working with you. And I played cricket for 20 years.
استحوذت لعبة الكريكت على اهتمامك منذ الشباب، فلماذا الكريكت؟
Cricket because my mother had two older sisters and both older sisters' sons played cricket for Pakistan. One played cricket for Oxford, one for Cambridge. Both captained Pakistan in cricket. So they were older than me and they were my heroes and role models. And my family, they were all my cousins played cricket. My mother had only one brother. He played cricket, you know, so it was really in our family.
استكملت تعليمك الدراسي في مدرسة القواعد الملكية في إنجلترا. كيف تعاملت مع البيئة المختلفة ثقافيا تماما عن لاهور؟
I had never been out of Pakistan till I went to England at the age of 18. I got selected for my national team to play. So when I finished the cricket tour in England, I had promised my mother that I would complete my education. So I was still in school when I got selected. So I went to this grammar school to finish my A-levels. I went there for 1 year. And it was the most difficult year of my life. At the time, I had never seen the English winter. We love winter in Pakistan. It's the best time of the year. In England, it was cold and it was raining and I was in a boarding. I'd never been out of my house. I always stayed at home. And I'd always grown in this place called Zaman Park, but they were all of my family, my cousins were there. So suddenly I had met new people, it was in a boarding, and then I had to study after a year break. So I think it was up till that in my life, it was the most difficult year.
لماذا وقع الاختيار على دراسة الاقتصاد والسياسة في جامعة أكسفورد؟
I studied politics and economics at Oxford, because I was always interested in politics, of international relations, of world politics of the Muslim world. I was always interested in that. So, and economics I didn't really like. So I did very well in politics, I didn't do very well in economics.
That's up in the air, he's getting under it, this could be victory, it is! Pakistan win the World Cup!
حققت انتصارات متتالية في الكريكت حتى توجت بكأس العالم للكريكت عام 1992. هل تذكر لحظة الفوز هذه؟
You see, when you reach the top 11 in your country, top 11 sportsmen in your country and cricketers, and then when you compete internationally, it is a lot of passion and hard work. You know, there are a lot of disappointments. It teaches you actually how to struggle. The problem with human beings is that when they are trying to achieve some goals, when the difficult times come, they give up. So sports teaches you the ability to take the bad times, how to cope with the bad times, how to cope with defeat, the dynamics of picking yourself up again. So you actually become mentally very strong when you have victories and you have defeats. You learn both how not to lose your head when you win, and at the same time, not get demoralized when you lose. And so when you work hard and then you achieve victory, it is a great feeling of satisfaction. I was only playing the World Cup because I wanted to build a cancer hospital. And I needed to win the World Cup to give enough publicity for the hospital. Otherwise, I had retired before. My passion in cricket had gone by then. And so when we won the World Cup, it was the feeling of great satisfaction because that was the last international match I would ever play. And at the same time, that win made me build this cancer hospital.
كما تقول بأن الرياضة تعلمك تتقبل الربح والخسارة. عمران خان كيف ينظر إلى الخسارة وكيف يتقبلها؟
When you first start playing and when you lose, you know, there were times when I would lose. You didn't want to wake up in the morning. You didn't want to get out of bed. You were so depressed. But gradually you understand failure is the best teacher because it gives you an opportunity to soul search, analyze your mistakes. Where did you go wrong? And then you correct your mistakes. And then you struggle again and you work hard and you come back much stronger. So life goes in cycles. Life never goes straight up. You go up, but it is the ability. How far you go up is the ability to cope when you're down. So therefore, that became my principle in life and politics. It became the same. I was building the hospital. It was a very difficult thing, you know, to build a specialized cancer hospital.
Yeah. I want to talk a lot about the hospital and your mother. Let me ask you this question. لماذا اعتزلت لعبة الكريكت في وقت كنت تتصدر فيه الساحة الرياضية؟
I had actually left 4 years earlier, but then the president of the country, he asked me to come back to play cricket again because I was at my peak. I only played for the hospital. In other words, this cancer hospital I was trying to build, I needed to raise a lot of money. And so if I felt if I was not in the limelight, I would not be able to raise the money. So that's why I kept playing. But once we won the World Cup, you know, I had achieved everything. So, you know, my passion was already gone. I wanted to do other things in life.
تحب والدتك كثيرا. ما هذا التأثير الذي تركته فيك لدرجة أنك سعيت بكل ما تملك لإنشاء مستشفى يتخصص بعلاج السرطان وهي التي ماتت بالسرطان؟
I was the only son. I had 4 sisters. And of course, you know, mothers sometimes love their sons more even than their daughters. But she loved me a lot. And, you know, I was very close to her. I was closest to my mother. She died a very painful death from cancer. I saw her suffer a lot. And so, you know, it made me realize that here I was a cricket star at the time. How expensive cancer treatment was. And I realized, how do poor people who get cancer, where do they go? Because I took my mother outside Pakistan for treatment because there was no specialized cancer hospital in Pakistan. And so the reason I built the hospital was because I felt, you know, in poor people, they end up selling everything for cancer treatment. So that's what wanted me to, in memory of my mother, but really for poor people. So it's the only private cancer hospital in the world where 70% of patients get free treatment, and it's a private hospital.
كيف حولت هذا المستشفى من فكرة إلى واقع؟
It was one of the most difficult thing. If I had not learned how to struggle from cricket, I would not have been able to build the hospital because there were very difficult times. You know, there was so much money to raise. Then no one had any idea how to build a specialized cancer hospital in Pakistan. So I traveled everywhere. I met doctors in America, Pakistani doctors working there. And then I met my first cousin was working in America. He then helped me organize the hospital side. He's brilliant. He's a genius. So he helped the hospital side. I then raised the money. I changed myself to become a fundraiser. I was a very introverted person. I never, you know, had much of a, didn't meet many people. I was shy. I became the biggest fundraiser in Pakistan.
مقربون منك قالوا لي تغير كثيرا بعد وفاة والدته، تغير للأفضل. لو كانت والدتك اليوم على قيد الحياة، ماذا كانت ستقول لك وأنت اليوم رئيس وزراء باكستان؟
She was very patriotic. You see, my mother and my father grew up in colonial India. We were a conquered. We grew up where the British were ruling India and what is now Pakistan. And when I grew up, I was the first generation of Pakistanis who grew up in an independent country. So all I remember is that she was fiercely patriotic. She hated the idea that we were, that we Muslims, we were at one time such a powerful nation in the world. And then us sort of becoming, you know, an enslaved nation. I guess she was such a proud person that she wanted Pakistan to be this great country. And my father, because both of them were, took part, they were involved in the Pakistan movement, you know, for our independence.
Do you miss her?
It's a long time ago when she passed away. And I guess because I built the hospital, and it was such a struggle to build the hospital. It's called Sadka Jariya. So when you build something where poor people get benefit and they pray, then the prayers go to her.
من الرياضة إلى السياسة، ما الذي دفع بشخص يملك بريق الشهرة إلى الخوض في السياسة ودهاليزها المغتمة إن صح التعبير؟
Actually, it was after my mother died. I moved towards spirituality. And I started, change my direction. And it happens to people sometimes in their lives ask themselves these two questions. What is the purpose of existence? And what happens to us after we die? And when you soul search these two questions, it leads you to the spiritual world. So I was already moving in that direction. And after I built the hospital, I always felt that Pakistan should be a welfare state based on the state of Medina. The Medina state built by a prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was the first welfare state in the history of mankind. And the objective resolution of Pakistan was by our founding fathers that it should be a welfare state. So therefore, number one, I wanted Pakistan to be a welfare state, which it wasn't. And secondly, we were ruled by these two corrupt families. And I knew both of them. You know, I knew Benazir Bhutto and I knew Nawaz Sharif. But they came into power and both of them were quite corrupt. They started making money. So corruption is something which destroys a country. Poor countries are poor not because they lack resources, but because their leadership is corrupt. So today, the developing world is poor because the ruling elites, the prime ministers and ministers and presidents of developing world, siphon off money, launder it into offshore accounts. And I call my party the Movement for Justice. Yeah. Because when you have justice, you don't have corruption.
عام 1996 أسست حزب إنصاف جاستس. ما هو الإنصاف الذي كنت وما زلت تسعى إليه؟
A society is only civilized when it has rule of law. So again, the state of Medina, our prophet peace be upon him, the state he set up. The two main guiding principles were rule of law, adl and insaf, and secondly was a welfare state. We had this corrupt ruling elite. Unless you bring them under the rule of law, the country has no future because, you know, when the ruling elite, when the prime minister and the ministers start stealing from the country can't survive that. In Lebanon, for instance, right now, I mean, Lebanon, Beirut was the Paris of Middle East. But because of the corruption of the ruling elite, it is becoming a failed state. So therefore, my fight in Pakistan was against this corrupt ruling elite, which was destroying, which was impoverishing, indebting our country.
هل هذا ما دفعك لقيادة المجتمع الباكستاني للخروج إلى الشارع وقلت حراك كامل.
Yes, it was. It was number one. I wanted Pakistan to be a welfare state, and number two, I wanted there to be rule of law, and through rule of law, fight corruption. So there were these two entrenched families, which were, they're not two political parties. They're actually family parties. They only, the leadership runs in the family. So fighting them was like fighting a mafia. You know, they were entrenched, they had money, they had, they used state resources. So it was a very tough struggle against them. Firstly, to displace a two-party system in a democracy is very difficult. In England, the two-party system stays, in the United States, in almost every country. Once you have two-party system, for a third party to come is very difficult. So it was a very difficult struggle. And then to fight people who were crooked and who had money, who used media against you and personal attacks. So it was a very tough struggle.
نتيجة هذه المواقف دخلت السجن كمعتقل سياسي. كيف كانت تجربة السجن؟
It was fortunately only for a week. I mean, I sometimes think that if I was put in jail, you know, I would much rather not live. Because you see, I have a very full life. I live life, you know, a very active life. And suddenly there was nothing to do. And I remember the day would not pass. I didn't know how to pass the day. I mean, I got some books. But, you know, I never experienced anything like that.
في حملاتك الانتخابية انتقدت السياسة الأمريكية والأوروبية على حد سواء وأنت الرجل المنفتح على الغرب. كيف توافق اليوم بين تفهمك للغرب ومصالح بلادك؟
You see, I understand Western politics much better than most people because I've spent so much time there. For instance, the main criticism was this war in Afghanistan. I felt that it was insanity what they were doing in Afghanistan. No Afghan was involved in 9/11, and you know, for Osama bin Laden and maybe a few hundred Al-Qaeda, you know, to occupy a whole country and occupy for 20 years, and I don't know what they were trying to achieve because no one is sure of their objectives. If they were going after Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda was gone after 2 years or 1 year at the most. So what was the objective? Nation building, liberating Afghan women, democracy. But whatever they were trying to achieve was not going to be achieved through military means, through military actions. And so I was always critical. I always said that their objectives could not be achieved through military solution. And so for that, I was criticized, you know, this imperialistic attitude that anyone who opposes you is anti you. I used to criticize the policy of my own government. It doesn't mean I'm anti-Pakistan.
بعد النضال السياسي من عام 1996 وصولا إلى 2018 20 عام أكثر من 20 عام وصلت إلى رئاسة الوزراء كيف كان وقع الفوز عليك؟
If you treat politics as a profession, then I would never have gone into politics because I had everything. I already was probably the biggest name in Pakistan. I had enough money that I wanted in life. So why would I go into politics? Because you know politics. There was nothing for me in politics. The people go into politics, unfortunately, in our country. Either no one knows them. Either they want to make money or they want to become a minister or something. For me, it was a mission. I felt that my country, you know, had given me so much. And then I always wanted to see my country, you know, on the cricket field, for instance. When I started playing cricket, we were right on the bottom. When I left, we were the world champions. So it gave me great pride to see my country rise. So my whole idea was to, you know, people like me who had everything, we should come into politics rather than those people who came into politics to make money. So that's why it was a mission for me.
وعدت قبل الفوز بأن تحارب الفساد في باكستان خلال 90 يوم. اليوم مرت أكثر من 3 سنوات. إلى أي مدى تعتقد بأنك حققت ما وعدت به؟
I always maintained that the main corruption, and the main corruption is the prime minister and the ministers. I said that would finish in 90 days. I think no one can point out to any corruption on the prime minister and his ministers. No one. And if any corruption on my own ministers came, I would be the first one to investigate. You know, we initiated a sugar inquiry where a couple of our own party members were involved. So if there's anyone who does corruption in my government, my ministers, I take action. I ask anyone to point out any corruption in our government. But of course, there are two types of corruption. One is the corruption which destroys a country of prime minister and ministers. But then there's a low-level corruption. That's much harder, because when a society gets used to corruption, when the government officers at low level get used to taking bribes, it takes a bit longer. And in our case, it's through automation we hope to eventually get rid of corruption, where there's less contact between the government officials and the people. And that's what, in, for instance, the tax collecting agency, that's what we're trying to do, to bring in automation.
أغلب السياسيين في باكستان يعينون أقربائهم في مناصب حساسة بحجة ضمان الولاء، دعني أقول. أنت لم تقم بذلك، ألا تخشى أن يتآمر عليك من حولك؟
Our role model is our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. His two great qualities were Sadiq and Amin. He was truthful and he was just. So when you're just, and that's the two essential qualities of being a leader, then you have to appoint people on merit, not because they are your friends, not because they are your relatives, because they deserve to be in the position. And if you look at the successful Western democracies, the leaders are honest, they are truthful, and they are just, and they award merit. So it's only when countries degenerate, when they have you know, poor leadership, when they don't have strong institutions, that they bring in their relatives and they bring in their friends.
المعارضة تتهم سياستك الاقتصادية بالتخبط والفشل في تخفيف معاناة رجل الشارع. بماذا ترد على هذا الاتهام؟
We inherited the most difficult situation that any Pakistani government has ever faced. We had the highest ever debt. We had the highest ever fiscal deficit of our current account deficit, were the highest in our life, the biggest deficits. So when a country is in that situation, it takes time for the country to recover, because basically you're trying to increase your income and you're cutting down your expenditure. So when you have this huge deficit, your expenditure is more and you have your revenues are below. So by the time you raise your revenues and cut down your expenditure, it takes time. We were doing very well. Then came COVID. And COVID-19 has affected the whole world. Pakistan, according to The Economist, is the number three country which best recovered from COVID. We dealt with the virus as well as our economy. So we navigated the best. But, you know, then now we have the strange situation, highest ever commodity prices. Oil has doubled. All edible items which we import, like edible oil, like wheat, like lentils, you know, which all of them have gone up. Freight has gone up. So it's an imported inflation which we have, which is where, or not just Pakistan, all economies in the developing world are struggling with it.
لديك توجه لتنظيم القطاع التعليمي لا سيما المدارس الدينية، ألا تخشى من ردود أفعال حادة، دعني أقول، من الجماعات الدينية التي ترى بأن مدارسها خط أحمر؟
You see, in Pakistan, we inherited three parallel education systems. One, a small one for a tiny elite. So about 800,000 Pakistani children go into English medium schools. About 33 million children go into the Urdu medium schools, and 2.5 million children go into Dini madrasas. So there are three parallel systems there. And so what we are trying to do is to bring them closer, have one core national curriculum. So we are trying to, Dini madrasas, we are trying to help them, and with a consultation, add more syllabus there so that their children can also become part of the mainstream. And the English medium schools, we are teaching them Urdu. And basically everyone, we have a core syllabus up till class five. So we have a unified system of education. And it's been difficult because, you know, for 70 years, this three-tiered system has been going on. But I think there's a consensus in Pakistan that, like everywhere in the world, we need a core curriculum to be the same.
تم تصنيفك أكثر من مرة بأنك واحد من أبرز 500 شخصية مسلمة في العالم وأكثرها تأثيراً. كقيادي مسلم، هل لديك أي استراتيجية لتوعية الغرب حول الإسلام الحقيقي؟
The problem with Muslim leaders is that they have never actually tried to explain Islam in its true essence to the Western countries. And therefore, when Islam gets maligned, there's propaganda against Islam, there is not a proper intellectual response from the Muslim leadership. So therefore, we have this phenomenon of Islamophobia, especially after, for instance, 9/11. There was no response from the Muslim leadership because terrorism has no relation to Islam. In fact, terrorism has no relation to any religion. When you say Islamic terrorism, it brands all Muslims. People can't tell the difference. How can an ordinary person in the West, how can he tell the difference between a radical Muslim and a moderate Muslim? So these terminologies actually cause Islamophobia. And unfortunately, the Muslim leadership never explained it to the Western countries or the United Nations or to the European Union. As a result, Muslims in the Western countries have suffered from Islamophobia.
في ظل تقاعس القادة عن تصحيح هذه الصورة، كيف ممكن أن يكون هناك حلول فعلياً لحالة تصاعد الإسلامophobia هذه؟
It has to be a joint response. It has to be a response by all the Muslim leaders. And we have forums like the United Nations. You have the United Nations General Assembly every year, where all of them can have a joint response. That's when it will make a difference. So just Imran Khan alone is not going to make that much of a difference. When we all get together, and all we have to do is make them understand that we have a completely different approach to religion than the Europeans or the Western countries. They get surprised when they insult our prophet or they make fun of our prophet. They get surprised when we react because they themselves don't treat religion like we do. So all we needed to do was to make them understand that for us, when anyone insults or ridicules our prophet, it is the most painful thing for Muslims because he lives in our hearts and they cause us a lot of pain. But they don't know this.
You as a leader, did you try to do that?
Oh yes, I in the United Nations in my first address to the UN Assembly, I said this. I explained to the Assembly that, you know, Prophet Islam is the most revered figure for us. We love and respect him. And we cannot bear him being insulted. Just like, for instance, the Jews. I mean, Holocaust for them is a very painful subject, understandably. And, you know, they don't like anyone even misinterpreting or having another version of Holocaust. They find it very offensive because it's painful for them. So the Western countries are very respectful. The way they treat Holocaust is with great sensitivity. We want them to treat, when they talk about our holy prophet, with the same sensitivity. But that can only happen if we as heads of Muslim state all together bring this up and make them understand this.
هذه الجهود على المستوى الدولي، لكن على المستوى المحلي أطلقت هيئة رحمة للعالمين. إلى ماذا تهدف هذه الهيئة؟
You see, we in our country, people, I think they love the Prophet. I don't know whether any other Muslim country loves him as much, but this country, they would die for the, you know, if anyone said anything to the our Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people would, you know, people would die for him. So. All I want is that, you know, this love should be converted to what the Prophet asked us to do, to his sunnah, to his sharia, to his way of life. Because the Quran orders us that we must follow the way of the Prophet, because he is a living Quran. He personified what is in the Quran. So therefore, we are ordered to follow his way. So all I want our younger generation is to learn. So the Rahmatul Alameen authority, there are various things, but one of the things is that in universities and colleges, we want there to be research done about his seerat, his life, so that our youth is aware of his life, his history. How did he change the world? How did he transform those Arabs into leaders of the world? How did two superpowers of the time crumble in front of this war of ideas, you know, which he raised the morality of these people. He made them into leaders for them to understand that they are, you know, there's a Western culture, but there is an Islamic culture. You know, you can't force anyone to follow anything. There's no compulsion in religion, but we must at least give our youth this option that there are two ways of life. You know, there's so much social media, there is Western films.
إلى أي مدى تعتقد بأنك ستنجح في هذه المهمة، خاصة وأن الجيل الجديد متهم، دعني أقول البعض منه متهم بأنه جيل رقمي مهتم بالسوشيال ميديا متأثر بالغرب.
I went as an 18-year-old to England. My heroes were all English. You know, the pop stars, the movie stars, sportsmen, they were all foreigners. And so I tried to follow them because you follow your role models. All I want is that our younger generation, they should have our Prophet, peace be upon him, as their role model. Because he was the greatest human being ever born on this earth. No human being has achieved or can achieve what he achieved in this world. All I want is our younger generation to know the qualities. What did he preach? How did he transform human beings? How did he change the characters? How did he make them these leaders? He was Rahmatul Alameen. Means that he was a mercy for mankind, not just Muslims. So any human being that follows his model will rise, because he set up a state of compassion, of welfare, where a state took responsibility of the weak, and then he established rule of law. He emphasized on the importance of education. And then he created leaders by reforming their characters. My point is, our younger generation, they can go into the digital world. They can go anywhere. But they must know the life of a prophet. That is the idea of this authority, that a younger generation, which is now bombarded by information, social media, they must also know the way of a prophet.
تسعى لإرساء حياة النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم على حياة الشباب. أنت كيف تطبق هذا النموذج؟
Well, it was about 30, at the end of my cricketing career, when actually I changed courses. It was through a great Sufi who, all the Sufis are lovers of the Prophet. And so he sort of changed my direction, and I was already seeking anyway. So the reformation of your character starts. The moment you change your directions and you make the Prophet your role model, so then you start reforming yourself. It's not like a button you turn on and off. It is a constant reformation of character. So when you pray five times, all you ask is, you keep asking Allah to show you the way of those he has blessed, and he's blessed our Prophet most of all. Not the other way, not the way who've gone astray. So all your life you pray that, which means all your life you're trying to reform your character.
في ظل التطورات السياسية وسيطرة طالبان على أفغانستان، ما هي خيارات باكستان للتعامل مع الوضع الجديد؟
You see, it's a very difficult situation for Pakistan. because the United States, which is the leading power, they're in a state of shock of what has happened in Afghanistan, because they never, the people of United States thought that they were bringing in democracy and nation building and liberating the women. That's what the people in the US thought. So when suddenly the Afghan government collapsed and the Afghan army gave up without a fight and Taliban are back in power, they can't understand what's happened. And there's a lot of anger in the US. So they're not thinking rationally. But what they don't realize is that we're talking about almost 40 million Afghan people, human beings. And if they do not get aid very quickly, if they do not help these people very quickly, which already were 50% were below the poverty line, then there's going to be a huge humanitarian crisis. Chaotic Afghanistan could again have international terrorists. Already they have ISIS. And if that happens, you must remember that US spent 20 years in Afghanistan and NATO. They spent over $2 trillion. So after all that, imagine if there is chaos in Afghanistan, if Afghanistan is worse off now than it was when they came in 2001. So therefore, it is very important for them to help. And unfortunately, if things go wrong in Afghanistan, Pakistan will be the biggest sufferer because we have a 2,600 kilometer border with Afghanistan.
في ظل هذا التوتر لدى الجارة أفغانستان كيف يمكن أن تحمي باكستان منها؟
This is a big worry for us. It's if Afghanistan descends into chaos, there's very little Pakistan is going to be able to do because when after the Soviets left in 1989. And Afghanistan descended into chaos and a civil war where hundreds of thousands of Afghans died, there was a fresh wave of Afghan refugees. So Pakistan already hosts 3 million Afghan refugees. And if there's a further destabilization and chaos, Pakistan will be the country that will suffer the most. There's not much we will be able to do. If we close our borders, how do we justify if there are people on the border and in dire need of humanitarian help? It's been a very difficult situation for Pakistan.
تحاول باكستان كسب تأييد الدول الإسلامية والعالم حول قضية كشمير. إلى أين وصلت هذه المساعي؟
We have raised it internationally. What is happening in Kashmir is the worst violation of human rights and in a violation of international laws, violation of the United Nations Security Council resolution. 8 million people are living in an open prison, and there are about 900,000 Indian troops which are keeping them in this open prison. So we have raised it every forum. We have raised it in the OIC and we've spoken to Muslim countries, Muslim countries everyone has their own independent relationship with India. So we can't expect much. But we as Pakistan feel it's our duty to raise this issue on every forum, the issue of Kashmir.
بالحديث عن العلاقات الباكستانية الهندية شهدت تهديد من وزير الداخلية الهندي بأن الهند قد تقدم على قصف مناطق انتقائية في باكستان. ماذا لو صدقت نيودلهي؟ كيف سترد باكستان؟
If they do any strike in Pakistan, Pakistan will respond exactly the way Pakistan responded in February 2019. When they did a strike in Pakistan, Pakistan will have to respond. It is this fascist BJP government in India, which if it does that, which it did before too, then it risks two nuclear armed countries coming face to face. Only mad people can think of this, the two nuclear armed countries coming face to face. People of India are more sensible. Unfortunately, they're being ruled by fanatics.
بعيدا عن السياسة كيف تقضي وقتك؟
Well, these days not much. I have been very busy these 3 years. There's been no social life or anything. So you know, the only thing my is to go up in the mountains. When in the summer I spend you know, some weekends up in the mountains, but that's about it.
تحب الأشجار وسعيت لزراعة أكثر من 2 مليار شجرة؟
As a child, I grew up spending my summer holidays in the mountains in the Himalayas. So I was always in touch with nature. I was always an environmentalist because I knew Pakistan has some of the most beautiful mountain scenery in the world. I've been everywhere in Switzerland and in Austria, but nowhere do you have the beauty you have in the Pakistan, in the Karakorams, in the Himalayas, in our mountain ranges. I always thought that the environmental degradation by our governments, allowing our forests to be cut, trees to be cut, and our environment destroyed, wildlife disappearing. So I always thought if I ever got the chance, I will start again reforestation in this country and so that our wildlife comes back. And so that's why we started this huge, ambitious 10 billion trees tsunami, we call it, we're planting. We've already planted 2.5 billion trees.
ما شاء الله. ترتدي في كثير من الأحيان الزي الباكستاني. ما الذي يعنيه لك؟
It means that I'm a prime minister of a country when over 90%, 94, 95% of the people wear these clothes. So who am I representing? Am I representing these vast 90% of the people or a tiny sort of westernized elite? And I consider myself, you know, a Pakistani of my people. And I think they don't want to see their leader not representing them. We have this colonial hang-up, unfortunately, in ex-colonial countries, where you always, the elite always wanted to look like the colonialists, so they used to ape them. It's what my people wear, although I'm very comfortable with Western clothes too. But, you know, since the prime minister represents his people, that's why I wear my Pakistani clothes.
أصبت بكورونا، كيف كانت هذه التجربة؟
Well, my wife and I got it, both of us at the same time. And so it was 5 difficult days. You know, where we slept a lot because you don't have any energy in you. But I was, seventh day I was working again. But I was still weak. It took me about 8-9 days to recover.
رفضت إغلاق البلاد في فترة كورونا، والسبب؟
For simply one reason, that I wanted to know if I shut my country down, what will happen to the daily wages? What will happen to the informal workers who have to work every day to have money to feed their families? So if I shut the economy down, what will happen to the taxi drivers, to rickshaw drivers, to the ones who have stalls where they have sell to feed their families? So I did not want to crush the poor. And that's why we came up with smart lockdowns. Just in certain areas we used to lock them down. But I could not bear. I mean, they would die of hunger. So you're trying to save people from corona, but kill people from hunger. I was not prepared to do that.
ما هو العنوان الذي قد تختاره لتلخص تجربتك في هذه الحياة؟
I don't know. I guess someone who actually who was very fortunate, privileged. Allah was very kind to me. He gave me almost everything I ever wanted. So in return, I feel it's my duty to do my best for fellow human beings. And I try my best. That's it.
أنت قدوة لعدد كبير من الشباب في العالم العربي والإسلامي. وهذا الشباب بعضه محبط، البعض يعاني من البطالة، من شؤون معيشية صعبة في بلاده. ماذا تقول للشباب العربي والمسلم؟
You see, we human beings, are God's greatest creation, Ashraful Makhlukat. And most of us don't realize how much potential Allah has given us. Because we have very small ambitions. We have very limited material ambitions. You know, designer clothes and fast cars and, you know. We are as big as we think, as big as our dreams are. So, you know, to the Muslim youth, I would say have big dreams. You know, think of yourself. The bigger you think, the higher you will get. And the dreams should never be material. Because if you If anyone thinks that happiness lies in making a lot of money, they will never find happiness. Happiness lies when you serve other human beings. Happiness lies when your soul is happy and your soul is connected with Allah. And so when Allah is happy, you're happy. And He's happy when you help as human beings. All the great people in this world always thought above themselves. You know, they're like a prophet. They didn't come into this earth to make money and build big buildings. They came for other human beings, and that's why they are still loved.